In Acts chapter 17, we have a very important passage, just a couple of verses that are so important for us as believers. Acts chapter 17, verse 10, it says this, "As soon as it was night, the brothers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now the Bereans were of more noble character than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true." Do you understand what these people were doing in Berea? The apostles would come, they'd preach a message, but the people, they were excited about the message, they liked the message, but they didn't just take it for granted that it was truth. It said that every day they would look into the Bible and make sure that what Paul said was really true. They would judge it against the Word of God. And I bring that up because it's so important that as you come here week to week, that you don't trust me, okay? I mean, seriously, that you don't just completely, I mean, trust me somewhat, okay? But I can get ridiculous, but you know, but that you don't trust me completely and just say, well, you know, he's up on stage, you know, it's a big church, you know, I'm sure he's teaching the Word of God. No, you don't know that. We need to be, the Bible really lifts up those Bereans and says they were of more noble character than the Thessalonians because they really studied the scriptures to see if what the guy up front was saying was really biblical. How do you know that I'm not going to lead you astray? How do you know that I'm not some cult leader or that I don't become one? Or how do you know I'm not the Antichrist? You know, I mean, really, what do you know about me? You know, the issue is we trust this book. We trust what God has written. And we have to, no matter who is speaking to you, you've got to look in the Word of God and say, okay, was that really biblical? And so I'm glad some of you noticed last week, wait a second, he skipped verse 27. Because verse 27, if you look in Luke chapter 9, you know, remember the context of what I was talking about last week. Jesus tells his disciples, I'm going to die, and I'm going to rise again. If you remember, the disciples were thinking, well, no, you're going to reign. You're the Messiah. The Messiah is the one that's going to stay on the earth. He's going to rule the whole world. And Jesus says, no, I'm going to die. But then I'm going to rise again, and I will return one day in all of my glory and then rule the world. But he says to them, he goes, if you're ashamed of my words, in verse 26, remember he says, if anyone is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory and in the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. Then in verse 27, it says, I tell you the truth. Some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God. That's a strange verse, isn't it? In fact, some people use that verse to say, you know what? Look, Jesus was wrong. Jesus said that he told his disciples, he says, look, if you're ashamed of me, I'll be ashamed of you when I return with my glory in my angels. When I come back, I'll be ashamed of you. And then he says, and some of you standing here, you're not going to die until you see the kingdom of God. And so people go, see, look, Jesus thought the disciples were going to see his return. That at least some of them saying they were going to stay alive until Jesus Christ returned. And now it's thousands of years later. He still hasn't returned. So Jesus was wrong. And people use that as a text. And yet you got to understand, what did Jesus exactly say? Did he say that they were going to see the Son of Man return? Did he say that you're going to see me when I come back with my angels and you're going to live until that point? No. He says you're going to see the kingdom of God. Some of you will not die before seeing the kingdom of God. And what happens next in the passage that we're studying now? Okay, Matthew, Mark, and Luke all record this next passage of Scripture right after Jesus makes that statement to show that this next section of Scripture is the fulfillment of that statement. When Jesus says, some of you are going to see the kingdom of God before you die, some of you standing here, that's exactly what happens in this next passage that we're looking at today. Look at verse 28. It says, about 8 days after Jesus said this, he took Peter, John, and James with him, and he went up onto a mountain to pray. As he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. Two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor talking with Jesus. they spoke about his departure, which he was about to bring to fulfillment at Jerusalem. Peter and his companions were very sleepy, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men standing with him. As the men were leaving, Peter said to them, "Master, it's good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what he was saying. While he was speaking, a cloud appeared and enveloped them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. A voice came from the cloud saying, "This is my son, whom I have chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, they found that Jesus was alone. The disciples kept this to themselves and told no one at that time what they had seen. Okay, what did Jesus say? Jesus said, "Some of you standing here will not taste death until you see the kingdom of God." And then what happens? He takes three of them, not all the disciples. He says, "Some of you standing here." 8 days later, he takes three of them and takes them up to a mountain, and he shows the disciples he himself in his glory. They see Moses and Elijah come down. They see the cloud representing God and a voice from the cloud speaking. See, this was the fulfillment of what Jesus said, that some of you aren't going to taste death until you get to see the kingdom of God. You got to remember the timing, too. Jesus tells his disciples that he's going to die. Remember that? And that's a shock to them. It's the first time he really explains it to them. "I'm going to die." Now, that must have been such a shock, because you're expecting him to reign. And then he says, "I'm going to die, and if you want to follow me, you're probably going to die also." Now, after that moment, the disciples must have been discouraged. They must have even questioned, "Is this really the Messiah?" Because any good Jew knows that when the Messiah comes, he's going to reign on the earth. He's not going to come and die. Man, I've been studying the Old Testament, and we've believed in this Messiah who's going to reign, and now you're telling me you're going to die? It must have gone through their mind, "This is so different from everything we've learned," because they didn't understand the totality of the Old Testament, you know, as I described last week. They didn't see, you know, the other passages. And so in their minds, they must have been thinking, "Well, maybe he's not really the Christ. If he's going to die, maybe this isn't the Jesus, the Christ that we've been waiting for." And so therefore, Jesus takes them up on this mountain and shows them his glory. And Moses and Elijah and God the Father himself speaking through the cloud, so they could know, okay, this is him. This is really the Messiah. This is a scene that must have stuck in their minds for the rest of their lives. In fact, if you turn to 2 Peter, it's in the end of your Bible. 2 Peter. Do you guys know who wrote 2 Peter? Peter, good. I point that out because who did Jesus take up on the mountain with him? Peter, James, and John. And in 2 Peter chapter 1, this is a very important passage to look at when you are studying the transfiguration. That's what we call this section of Jesus kind of changing up there on the mountain. It's called the transfiguration. So if you ever hear that term, this is what they're referring to, that time when Jesus transfigured before them. And in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16, look what Peter writes later on in his life. He says, "We did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory, saying, 'This is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased.' We ourselves heard this voice that came from heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain." See, so Peter says, he goes, "Remember when I told you about the glorious coming and how Jesus is going to come?" He goes, "When I told you that story," he goes, "it wasn't just some cleverly invented story that someone made up and told me." He says, no, it's not about that. He goes, "I saw him come in his glory. I saw his majesty. I was an eyewitness of that. So I know for a fact that Christ is going to return in his glory because I got to see a glimpse of that." He says, "When I was on that sacred mountain, and when I heard that voice, when God said, 'This is my son.'" And so Peter here writes later on in his life, he says, "Look, I know what I believe to be true because I saw it. I know Christ will return one day because I saw his glory. I saw his majesty on that mountain." Remember what John writes. John chapter 1, verse 14. You guys know who wrote John? Okay. John. And who was on the mountain? Peter, James, John. John chapter 1, verse 14. The Word became flesh and dwelt for a while among us, and we beheld His glory. See, John talks about the glory that he saw. You know, in 1 John, he talks about how he's an eyewitness of these things. These things aren't things he made up. So Peter and John, this left a lasting impression. I mean, can you imagine if you went up on that mountain and you see someone that you've been living with, suddenly his face starts glowing. And suddenly his whole body is shining before you. Suddenly these two heavenly beings come down and stand next to him. Then a cloud comes and this huge voice, the voice of God, starts speaking. You think you'd forget that? It was something that was going to be etched in their minds forever. You ever seen anything like that, that you just still have pictures of, you still remember? How many of you, by show of hands, remember the movie that we saw in Driver's Ed, Red Asphalt? Look at that. I mean, that was so long ago, and they're still showing that movie. But you still remember, they wanted to give you a vision. Red Asphalt, that was the movie where people would come out of their cars all bloody and go, oh, I should have worn my seatbelt, you know. And why? Because they wanted us to be safe drivers, and they wanted us to put our seatbelt on and everything else. And it was this picture to stay in our mind, okay? It's one of those graphic things. Well, I really believe that's what the transfiguration was all about. It was something to stay in their minds. Because remember, Jesus is preparing his disciples for a life of danger. You know, many of them were going to die in his name. But you know what they could do? They could look back to this day. And they could say, I saw him in his glory. I remember that cloud. I remember seeing Moses and Elijah, and it would be a sight that they would see that would bring them comfort. I mean, knowing that this is the Jesus that I serve, it would bring them comfort, having that high view of God. And I bring that up because this passage is meant to bring us comfort. It's to remind us that we serve a holy God, a very glorious God. And sometimes we forget that. Sometimes we can look at everything else in the world and get kind of scared. I mean, honestly, probably most of us have turned on the news in the last few weeks, and it's not real comfortable, is it, watching the news nowadays? You start staring at these things and going, wow, look at what's going on in Iraq, and look at how there's not so much unity with the other countries, and are we going to have to stand alone? What are they going to do to us? Who's going to turn on us? Then you look at North Korea, and you go, wow, and then all of them are making these, you know, these nuclear weapons, and you're going, and you're seeing pictures of missiles going here and there, and troops are going everywhere, and you're going, who's with us? Who's against us? What's going to happen? What's going to happen this week? What's going to happen next week? When are we going to go to war? What kind of world are my kids going to grow up in? What's going to happen to the United Nations? What's going to happen to NATO? What's going to happen to all these things? And you can almost get panicked. You can start living in fear, knowing chemical warfare is coming. You know, man, what am I breathing in this room? What's going on? But then you take your eyes off of all of those things, and you picture yourself on that mountain. And you see Jesus shining like the sun. See two heavenly beings standing by him. You see that cloud of God just saying, this is my son, listen to him. You picture all that power and you focus on that and you realize, wait, that God is still on his throne. If I keep my eyes on him, if I keep my eyes on that picture, I can make it through anything because I know that that God is for me. You see, this must have been such a comforting time in the life of the disciples. They're going, I'm on his side. What do I have to fear? And I believe this is something they look back to for the rest of their lives, all the way up until they're martyred for the name of Jesus Christ, saying, I can do this. I saw Moses come back to life. So that means this isn't going to be the end of my life. I saw Jesus come back. I saw Elijah. This isn't the end. I can die for him. Huge, huge passage. And so important to us, because if we have a high view of God and we fear him, then we don't have to fear anything else. But he takes Peter, James, and John, who are like an inner circle. Okay, he's got his 12 disciples, right? His 12 disciples, these are the guys he's building into. But Peter, James, and John seem to form like an inner circle. Like they were the ones that were really in with him. And there are certain things that they get to experience, such as the transfiguration, that the others didn't get to experience. Those three are always mentioned first whenever they list out the disciples. And he takes them up to a mountain. He goes up to a mountain to pray. I'm not going to say a lot about this, but I will say there's something about getting on a mountaintop and praying. I don't know if you've ever done it, but some of the greatest times I have had with God have been on a mountaintop. And you see Jesus oftentimes getting away from the city, going up on a mountain and praying. And if you have never done it, do it. There's something about the effort, too, of saying, you know what, I'm going to take my time, I'm going to go up that mountain and spend time alone with God, rather than, ooh, I got 5 minutes before I got to get to work, and I'll jump in my car real quick and say a quick prayer. Yeah, that's great, that's important, but there's something about those times in our lives when we say, you know what, I need to just get away from it all. Not to go play, nothing else, I just want to be alone with God. And to climb up on top of a mountain. We got all these hills around here. It's not that hard to do. And just get away and just say, God, I just want to be with you. Because the passage says that as he was praying, his appearance changed. Okay, it's during that time of prayer that that's when the amazing things happen. I mean, when did Moses' face start glowing? When he's up on that mountain with God, right? Comes down from the mountain and people are like, get away from me. Your face is glowing. Why? He was alone with God. And here Jesus, alone with the Father, his face more than glows. Matthew says it's shining like the sun. And let me just say this. There is nothing in your life that can replace your time alone with God. There's nothing that will substitute for that. It's great that you're here. It's great that you're here, you're worshiping God, and you need to be here worshiping God. It's great that you're in Bible studies with other people. It's great if you listen to Christian radio while you're in your car. But I'm telling you, you're not going to see the amazing things happen in your life until you are serious about spending time with just you and God. And there is nothing more important you can do. Is there anything more important that you have to do tomorrow that is more important than being alone with God? Seriously, think through your calendar. Think through what you have to do tomorrow. What is more important than coming to the presence of Almighty God? And I tell you, when you begin to see that as a priority, your life will change. And here Jesus is praying, his face starts changing, and Matthew says that his face shone like the sun. And again, in Revelation chapter 1, remember when John sees Jesus in Revelation 1, it says his face was like the sun in its full strength. Think about it. Have you ever looked at the sun in the middle of the day? Not a brilliant idea, but you can't stare at it. Now imagine if you're standing there with a friend of yours on a mountain and suddenly his face becomes shining like the sun to where you can't even look at him. And then his body starts glowing all the way through his clothes. That's going on with Jesus. What's that all about? For some of you, that may be a weird concept. Why in the world would he shine like that? Well, 1 John 1:5 says that God is light, and in him there's no darkness at all. Psalm 104, verse 2 talks about how God clothes himself or covers himself with light. And there's a very interesting and important verse in 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 16. Listen to the words of this. 1 Timothy 6, verse 16. Talking about God, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who alone is immortal and who lives in unapproachable light, whom no one has seen or can see. To him be honor and might forever. Amen. He talks about God and he says that God dwells in unapproachable light. Think about what those two words mean. Unapproachable light. Think about that. What does that do to you to think that right now, as you're sitting comfortably in this room, there is a being up in heaven who dwells in unapproachable light? That somehow he is a light, he is a brilliance that is so bright that you cannot approach him. It says that no one has ever seen him. No one can look upon that light. Why? Because it's unapproachable. You gotta understand, God in His full glory is so brilliant that if I tried to approach and come into His presence, I would die. It's unapproachable light. You know, it's like those nuclear signs. You can't approach. You can't get near to it. You'll die. You'll die. You can't look at it. You'll die. That's what it's saying about God. He dwells in unapproachable light. Does that mean anything to you right now? That as you and I sit here and we're looking at other people, you know, this is normal. There's a holy God set apart from us who's different, who is so different that He dwells in unapproachable light. We need to be very careful when we talk about God. And we need to be careful, okay? Because there's a lot of paintings of Jesus that we see, a lot of sculptures, statues, things like that, which I don't think are necessarily sinful. But when we look at them, we need to be careful to remember that that is not Jesus. And that is not even portraying what Jesus is like right now. That is showing Jesus when He was a human, when He became, when He emptied Himself of His glory. Okay, that is not the way He appears right now. Okay, and when you pray, that's not who you're praying to. You're praying to a glorified Christ. See, the Bible teaches, Philippians chapter 2, that when Christ came, it says that He didn't consider equality with God something to be grasped or something that He held on to, but He humbles Himself. He lowers Himself and takes the form of a man. And the Bible literally says that He emptied Himself. Jesus emptied Himself, it says there in Philippians 2. What did Jesus empty Himself of when He came down to the earth? Well, one of the things for certain is His glory. Because if Jesus had come down in all of His glory, the whole world would have died, and that would have defeated the purpose. Okay? He came down. He had to empty Himself of His glory to come down. That's why in John chapter 17, when Jesus is praying to the Father, He says, Father, I've completed the work You gave Me to do. And now, Father, glorify Me in Your presence with the glory I had with You before the world began. Is I'm done with My work now, so take Me back into heaven and give Me the glory I used to have, the glory I had before the world began, because I'm done with My mission here on this earth. Jesus prays that as He's getting ready to die and go back into heaven, go back into glory. Okay? So when you see those pictures of Jesus, know, okay, that was when He was here down on the earth. We're trying to draw some picture of what He might have looked like, but that was Him emptied of His glory. Here, the disciples are getting to see a glimpse of the glory of God. Not all of it. Not all of it, because if they saw it all, like the Bible says, He dwells in unapproachable light and no man can see that. Just like God told Moses when Moses said, I want to see Your glory. He says, you can't see Me. No man can see My face and live. That's the God we worship. And we have to be so careful when we talk about God. I saw a skit this week that really disturbed me. And it's people that I'm sure were well-meaning and had hearts that wanted to serve God. But it was a skit on a stage where one person was supposed to be God, okay? Which I think is just a scary thing to do anyways, you know, to portray Him. And it was the things that they had God saying. And they had this angel Gabriel coming to him and saying, well, you know, I think you should love those people, and making these suggestions to God and teaching God about love. Saying, hey, and don't forget this, God. It's like, it just grated against me. It's like, you know, we have to be very, very careful that we don't lower our view of God. And that we certainly don't lower other people's views of God. Do you realize that there are people here today, people who exist on the earth who still won't even say the word God because they believe it's so sacred? In the Old Testament, they would never say God. They would just say the name. Oftentimes even covering up their heads as they say, the name. You know who I'm talking about. Yet today, we'll just kind of throw the name God out there and just treat Him so casually. And we've got to be very careful with that. Because when we are talking about God, we are treading on holy ground. And we do not want to lower anyone's view of God. God is a God who dwells in unapproachable light. He is a being who is so holy, so set apart from us. There's no way you could just walk up into his presence and look at him and die. And here Jesus is showing this. He's shining. And then Moses and Elijah show up. That may seem kind of peculiar. Why would Moses and Elijah be there with Jesus? A couple thoughts. It's interesting that it's Moses and Elijah, because how did Elijah die? He didn't, right? He didn't die. He was taken up into heaven into a chariot. No one killed him or anything else. How did Moses die? Moses did die. But the interesting thing about his death that is mentioned in Scripture is that no one knew where his bones went. No one knew where his grave was. And so you have these two men that come back from the Old Testament that had these very peculiar exits of the earth. But not just that, I want to explain something else. Okay, when we talk about the Old Testament, Jesus would often say the law and the prophets. Okay, you can sum up the law and the prophets by these two commands. Remember that? The law and the prophets. Because when you talk about the Old Testament, a lot of people call it the law and the prophets. When you think of the law, who do you think of? Moses. When you think of the prophets, who do you think of? Elijah. There are other prophets, there are other people who gave law, but you think about Moses and Elijah. Any good Jew would. Now, think about what's going on here. You've got Moses and Elijah talking to Jesus. You see, because remember the mindset of the disciples and the timing. They may have been thinking, you know what, Jesus, you said you're going to die? Wait a second, I'm not sure I can find that in the Old Testament. I'm not sure I totally grasp that concept, because me studying scriptures, I've always thought the Messiah would reign. I didn't understand the second coming. And so you may have questioned, is this really the Christ of the Old Testament? But then he starts glowing. Then Moses and Elijah, the law and the prophets, come and talk to Jesus. And what are they talking about? They're talking to him, it says, about his departure, about how he was going to die and rise again, and how these things were going to be fulfilled at Jerusalem, it says. To be fulfilled means to complete a task. You've got Moses and Elijah, the law and the prophets, talking to Jesus and saying, yeah, this is what's going to happen. You're going to go to Jerusalem, you're going to die, you're going to rise again. Now, if the disciples doubted what Jesus said earlier, you know, when he said it himself, now they've got the Old Testament law and the prophets, Moses and Elijah, saying the same thing. Now, in verse 32, it talks about how Peter and his companions were tired. They were sleepy. Luke is the only one that mentions that fact. But it says, when they became fully awake, they saw his glory, the two men standing with him. And it says, as the men were leaving Jesus, Peter said to them, Master, it's good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Okay, so Moses and Elijah are about to leave, and Peter goes, no, wait. This is good. This is so good that you guys are here. Let me build three tabernacles for you. Let me build three tents for you, which could have been referring to the Feast of Tabernacles that was coming up. Because let me put these up for you so you can stay. It may have been Peter in his mind thinking, this is the kingdom. I mean, this is, okay, when he saw Jesus in his glory and he sees Moses and Elijah standing with him, this is probably what all the disciples pictured the kingdom of God would look like. Okay? When the Messiah comes, he's going to come in his glory. He's going to have Old Testament saints with him, and he's going to rule. And so Peter's saying, you know what, let me set up some shelters for you, and let's do it now. And then in parentheses it says, he didn't know what he was saying. I love that phrase. It makes me feel better. He did not know what he was saying, which is typical of Peter. You know, a lot of times he would just open his mouth and say something, and I got to do something. I want to keep these guys here. Because, you know, probably with a good heart, just, you know, I want to linger here. I mean, can you imagine standing there in the presence of the glorified Christ with Moses and Elijah on that mountaintop? Why would you want that to ever end? But it says he didn't know what he was talking about. And then in verse 34, it says, while he was speaking, it's talking about Peter, while he's still saying, look, I'll make you a really good one. You know, this is, while he's still speaking, a cloud appeared and enveloped them. And they were afraid as they entered the cloud. A voice from the cloud saying, this is my son whom I have chosen. Listen to him. When the voice had spoken, they found that Jesus was alone. The disciples kept this to themselves and told no one at that time what they had seen. Okay, so that's the end of the story there. Moses and Elijah leave, and the disciples don't mention a word of this to anyone. Matthew explains the reason is because Jesus told them not to mention this to anyone yet. Now, but I want you to pay attention to what's going on. Peter just says, look, I'll build you a house. I'll take care of you guys. Stay here. And then a cloud comes. Okay, Old Testament, what did the cloud signify? It was God. Remember when they were in the desert and they're wandering around in the desert? They would follow the cloud by day and then the pillar of fire by night. And so now the cloud is coming. And out of this cloud comes the voice of God. The cloud covers them. If you're not already terrified, now the cloud comes. And at this point, when God starts speaking, Matthew records that they all fell on their faces and were afraid. Their faces to the ground, they were terrified now. They're hearing the voice of God. If they didn't get it about Moses and Elijah, now they've got God, and they would know that about the Old Testament. I mean, if you had any doubt of, well, is this really the same Jesus, the same Christ that was supposed to come in the Old Testament? Well, let me think. He's glowing. He's got Moses and Elijah attesting to it. And the cloud of God now is enveloping him. And the voice is saying, this is my son. Yeah, it's probably him. Okay? This is my son whom I have chosen. And he says, listen to him. Some say that may have been a direct statement to Peter. Peter, what did Jesus just say? He's going to die, he's going to rise again. What did Moses and Elijah just say? He's going to die, he's going to rise again. And you're wanting to set up tabernacles for them and start your kingdom now? He says, just listen to him. This is my son, whom I have chosen. Listen to him. He told you to deny yourself, take up your cross, follow him. Listen to him. The question I have for you today is, do you listen to him? Do you listen to the son? Do you read the words of Jesus and listen to it? A lot of times we'll read the word of God and we'll forget where it came from. That we'll take Jesus' words and we'll look at them as suggestions. Oh, no adultery? Well, okay, maybe. Don't hate, don't this, don't that. Well, whatever it may be, we kind of look at it as suggestions. Well, maybe I'll do that, maybe I won't do that. And sometimes we get so arrogant in our obedience of the Word of God, we'll pick and choose what we'll obey. But let me ask you something. What if, think about this, what if you got to experience that? What if, picture this, you are standing on a mountain right now, and you see Jesus shining, glowing, his face like the sun. You see these Old Testament beings coming down on the earth with him. Picture this. Live it out right now. You're seeing them in this glorious splendor. And then a cloud comes and covers you all, that you know this is God now. And then you hear a voice from the cloud saying to you, this is my son. Listen to him. You think you'd pay attention to what Jesus would say? God is saying that to us. My son said these words. Listen to him. My son told you not to hate. Listen to him. And we'll have the arrogance in the presence of that voice and that cloud to go, yeah, but do you know what he did to me? Forgive him? Forgive her? Do you know how she treats me? We'll have the arrogance to say, well, come on, you know, of course I can cheat on her. Look at how she's treating me. Of course I can leave her. We'll have the arrogance to say, you know what, I'm just cheating a little bit on my taxes. Just a little white lie. When God says, you listen to him. And these disciples with their faces to the ground, it helps you understand why they live such a holy life. Because they got a glimpse of God. And so often, we are so casual about his commands because we don't realize this came from the cloud. This came from the God who dwells in unapproachable light. He's the one that tells you not to gossip. He's the one that tells you to love one another. He's the one who tells you to not lust. to live your life in purity, to not commit adultery, not have premarital sex. He's the one that tells us these things, to love our neighbors as ourselves. That's coming from the cloud, saying, listen to him. You know, my very first sermon, when we first had the very first Sunday of this church, it was about a fear of God. It was about, look, when we come in this room, this is not about us trying to, you know, just be happy and do things to entertain us. It is about us recognizing who God is and giving him excellence in the way we hear his words and the way that we worship him. Everything begins with a fear of God. If you don't fear God, then you've missed the boat, because the Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And that's what these disciples are getting a taste of here.